What I thought was a very good question was left on my last video, which talked about backflushing your airbrush. Jesus C. wrote in part, "This method seems to go back and forth. Some think it's great to do so because it works. I've done it with zero problems. Some say you're putting your airbrush at risk. They've said backflushing can also mean putting paint into the air chamber, which can relate to saying goodbye to your airbrush. What are your thoughts on this? Is this just a myth?" It's an excellent question, and I could easily say I've done this for 30 years and I've never once got paint into the air chamber of any of my airbrushes. Does that mean it's impossible, or have I just been very lucky? The way that we really need to answer this question is to look at exactly how the airbrush works. To do that, we need to get inside the airbrush, and there's only one way I know to do that. Now, just so everybody is aware, this particular airbrush that I'm cutting in half is a very old airbrush. I've had this one for 25 plus years, and it got to the point where most of the internal parts are just worn out. It was actually cheaper for me to replace the airbrush in its entirety rather than buying separate parts and rebuilding it. I'm sure that was somewhat painful to watch, and I assure you it was even more painful for me to actually do that. So why did I do it? I have a picture of an airbrush cutaway that I've used in a previous video, but unfortunately that cutaway stops forward of the Teflon needle packing seal, and it doesn't show anything forward of that as far as the gravity feed cup, the fluid nozzle, and the air chamber up front. So now I have an airbrush cutaway of the entire airbrush. So let's talk about how all of this works. When you press the trigger on your airbrush, the trigger is actually pushing on a valve that is contained within the valve guide body. You can see the valve guide body right here. That O-ring is what seals the air chamber above. And if you see that little hole in the valve guide body, that comes into play in just a second. The valve itself has an O-ring on the top, which acts as an air seal, and it has a spring on the bottom, which is why your trigger comes back up when you let off of it. Holding the valve inside the valve body is the valve guide, and you can see the little notches on the sides of the valve guide. That allows airflow into the valve guide assembly. Here you can see the actual valve being pushed down when the trigger is pushed on an airbrush. Once the O-ring on the top of the valve is pressed below the hole in the valve guide body, it allows airflow into the airbrush. It looks something like this. So that illustrates the airflow making its way up into the head cap, which is right here where the fluid nozzle is located. The fluid nozzle has a compression fit, so that is an airtight seal. But it looks like there's a barrier between the head cap and the nozzle cap. So how is the air getting from the head cap into the nozzle cap? Here's a picture of a head cap, and if you look closely, you can see three very small holes at the front of the head cap. Those holes are what allows the air to travel through the head cap and into the nozzle cap. On the front of the nozzle cap is an orifice that allows the needle tip as well as the tip of the nozzle to protrude through the nozzle cap. That orifice is slightly larger than the tip of your needle and the tip of the nozzle, which allows the airflow to travel out the front of the airbrush. As the air travels out the front of the brush, it creates an area of low pressure. That area of low pressure is a direct result of the air being compressed as it flows through that very small orifice. which creates a vacuum. The vacuum draws the paint out of the airbrush, where it accelerates as it follows the taper of the inside of the fluid nozzle as well as the taper of the fluid needle, and then it's atomized into the airstream. The paint in your airbrush is stored in a completely separate chamber. So the only time the paint and the airflow are actually sharing the same space and mixing is forward of the fluid nozzle. So now that we have a better understanding of how all of that works, let's go back to the original question. Is it possible to get paint into your air chamber when you're back flushing your airbrush? I will stop short of saying it's absolutely impossible because I can see some crazy circumstances where that could actually happen, but it's highly unlikely. Here's the deal. When you are closing off the needle and the fluid nozzle on the front of your airbrush in order to backflush the brush, you're forcing air into the paint chamber, into the fluid nozzle, and ultimately into the gravity-fed cup. And that's why you see the bubbles in the cup. There's no paint coming out because you're backfeeding the brush. The only way that I can see that you could possibly get paint into the air chamber is if you had a failure in the fluid nozzle or crack in the fluid nozzle. It would have to be something pretty severe. I say that's highly unlikely because, as I mentioned in the beginning of this video, I've been airbrushing now for 30 years and I've never once experienced a catastrophic failure of that magnitude. Even if that ever did happen, chances are any paint that you could possibly get into the air chamber is more than likely going to stay in the nozzle cap because it would be very difficult for that paint to work its way through those three very small holes in the head cap. And that is not a failure that would require you to throw your airbrush in the trash. You can easily remove the nozzle cap and clean out any paint from within the nozzle cap and the front of the head cap. So I hope all of that makes sense. Jesus, I hope that answers your question thoroughly. I hope the rest of you got something out of this as well. If you did, remember to like, subscribe, and share. I'm Trevor with Wicked Art Studio, and I'll see you guys next time.